should say, I've come to listen to Sheikh Idris. May Allah Ta'ala reward him. He gave a beautiful talk. And it's so pleasing to hear your beloved be praised so eloquently. He praised our Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. May Allah Ta'ala reward him immensely in his life, in his family and children, with the love of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then we had some beautiful Munshids and Ismail and some beautiful singers. It's like so amazing, Bradford, mashallah. And then we have Mawlana Ustaz Ali in front of me, Mawlana Hafizuddin, the expert grammarian, and sure, many other gems seated here. So where do you begin? Allah Ta'ala reward you all, inshallah. And it's nice that we've come together today on New Year's Eve, where many people would be spending their night in the disobedience of Allah, ma'ad Allah, and Allah Ta'ala has honored us to come and sit in His house, take opportunity from this day and make zikr of Allah and share some reminders. The title I've been given today is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. What's after that?
A 21st century messenger.
A 21st century messenger. I completely understand what's been said, but I would say he's beyond the 21st century. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Where Allah Ta'ala says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. You've not been sent but as a mercy to the universe. He's a messenger until end of time and beyond end of time. And people will see his lofty, lofty station when they come in front of him on the day of judgment. When they're going to intercede before Allah, he will be the one upon whom mankind kneels and asks for intercession. He is the one who's going to begin intercession, and by means of him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people will enter Jannah. May Allah Ta'ala make us all amongst them. But indeed, the question being asked, that do we find, do we see that the teachings of the Messenger of Allah, alayhi salatu wa salam, who came over 1400 years ago, are they relevant today? Is Islam a backup religion? Does Islam fit in the age? And most definitely it does. But this topic requires, this topic has a lot of breadth, and it has a lot of depth. And to be able to speak and give due justice to this topic, and trying to highlight many issues, and give justice to each issue by speaking about them at length, is quite difficult for someone of my standing. But it's a beautiful topic, and I hope I'm able to share and shed some light on the beauty of the Islam that Rasulullah brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So first and foremost, when we say the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we mean Islam. When we say Islam, we mean the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are synonymous terms. There is no Islam without the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we find in him his teachings by word, which is the Quran and Hadith, and we find through him his actions, which is now his Sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when you ponder over everything that the Messenger of Allah did, and the ulama pondered, they concluded that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came with five primary goals, five objectives. Everything that he did was in order to attain these five principles. And this is the purpose of Islam, which is the very first of them, protection of faith. Protecting one's faith, protecting your deen. And the second of them is protection of life. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came to protect life, life of humans, all mankind. And the third of them, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, came, these are the objectives of Islam, he came to protect your wealth, your property. And he came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to protect your honor, your lineage, your dignity. And he came, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to protect your reason and your intellect. So these be considered to be the five objectives of Islam. So when I'm going to ponder some examples from the life of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah willing, or from his sunnah, you need to keep in mind that certain acts were prepared, or made, or done in light of these objectives. And this is what the Messenger of Allah came to give to human beings, a life of salvation, where people could live in a community and live in peace and harmony. This is the name of Islam. And in order for us to find peace and harmony and equality, there is a key component, which is al-adl, justice, al-qist. And this is what Islam speaks about in great detail. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَقْسِطُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. And be just, for Allah loves those who do justice. Allah loves those who are just. In another place, Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَىٰ أَنَّا تَعْدِلُوا اِعْدِلُوا وَأَقْرَبُوا لِلتَّقْوَىٰ. Don't let it be that your dislike towards the people prevents you from being upright and being just. Be just. This is closer to being pious. This is closer to piety. So justice, al-adl, is the key component for us to be able to live with one another in peace and harmony. And the most just amongst humans is the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He came to bring justice on earth. And whilst he was amongst us, amongst the Sahaba, alive on earth, he established a community around himself that lived with justice. And they preserved each other's life and wealth and honor and dignity. And this is important to understand, living in the society we live in, when we think to ourselves, has the world gone too far? Have they advanced? I will say the world is catching up. Catching up to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is on siratul mustaqim, he's on the straight path. When he came, people were in an extreme, where they would kill, they would bury children alive, girls alive, because they found it to be a disgrace that we have a daughter. Now we're talking about people that would think that it was intelligent and piety to make the wall of the Kaaba naked. Now we're talking about people who would continue to fight between a nation and another, which was caused because of an event that occurred 200 years prior, whereby one person's camel drank water before another person's camel, which led to bloodshed and has continued to the age that the Messenger of Allah came. We're talking about a very dark time. So he took people out of darkness and he put them on the straight path. And as people developed, sometimes what happens is you fall in another extreme. And that's where the world has fallen today. It's actually gone past the middle. The Messenger of Allah is in the middle, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He waved the straight way. The world has now trespassed and has gone to a state whereby they think they've developed, but in truth, this is not advancement. A simple example before our eyes is you find in the time of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, women being buried alive, having no rights, treated as soulless people. He, not only did he give them rights, he gave them honor and dignity. And they became individual people, and I'm going to shed some light on that. And he brought them to a standing in community. The world, now is realizing that this is what must happen, what should be, have moved on to such an extent where the women folk are used. So you look at any billboard and they're selling a car, you find a lady standing beside the car. What's the relevance between a lady and a car? We're living in an age where if a lady would uncover herself, it's considered to be freedom of expression. But if a lady would want to be chaste and modest and cover herself, she's backward. So that's the world that we're living in. So it's not that we have to try to find Islam fitting into the world that we live in. Not necessarily. If there is wisdom in the age that we are in, then this is a lost property of the believers. Al-hikmatu dalatul mu'min. Wisdom is the lost property of the believers. فهو حق بها أينما وجدها. He has more right over it wherever he finds it. And this is something that Muslims need to think and reflect on. It's not that you have to find Islam fitting into the West, into the 21st century. No, not necessarily. We have to come back to the middle, which is, let's find what is the truth. Where is the Sirat al-Mustaqim? You will find Rasulullah standing there, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's the embodiment of truth, of justice and equality. And you should find at some points of life, the world has gone to another extreme. And if it wants good for itself, if it is allowed by Allah Ta'ala to continue to exist, then it will come back to the middle way at the hands of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam ibn Maryam. So, coming to the point of today's topic, which is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the 21st century, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before the 21st century and beyond the 21st century, is his message outdated? Does it fit in? So my premise to today's talk is, it's not that Islam needs to fit in, it is rather the world needs to fit into the equality and justice he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam laid down on earth. One of the most important things that he came for is upholding life. Upholding life. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا وَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Allah Ta'ala says, whoever takes a soul unjustly, paraphrasing the verse, then it is as if he has taken life of all mankind. It's as if he has killed all of mankind. And whoever saves a life, it is as if he has saved mankind. This is what Quran teaches. The safety of life. One of the most beautiful examples you find in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his time whereby you'd only really be protected if you were from a high tribe or clan, or you knew someone from a high tribe or clan. So if you came into Mecca to make some trade and you want your wealth to be protected, your life to be protected, you have to come into custody of someone from the Meccan people. And when that person giving you custody, they will come towards the Kaaba and shout out and announce that this person is under my custody, which would then mean don't harm him, because if you harm him, you know, I'm going to defend him. And they'll find this a means of pride and honor that someone has come to us to seek our custody or our protection. It so happened that when the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam was in his youth, people would come into Mecca, would perform trade, and their wealth would be consumed, yet payment would not be given. And this became common. And the one who would take and consume the wealth, he would challenge that individual, go do what you want. So now the day and age we live in, if somebody takes your wealth unlawfully, you go and call the police, right? And you'll have some law and order coming in and settling the issue. Well, there's no police at that time. There's no government. It's the Quraysh, it's this tribe. They sit together, and whatever they agree upon is what happens. And if one of them have given protection, nobody will interfere. And if you've got no protection, tough luck, go back home. Now, some people started to feel uncomfortable. But look what's happening. Someone's coming to Mecca to trade, yet they're not being dealt with fairly, with justice. So, a meeting was held on Mount Safa in a particular person's home, an elderly gentleman, and certain nobles were invited to this meeting. From them was the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Talib. And Abu Talib took his nephew with him. Rasulullah was a young man at this age, in his 20s, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq also happened to be in that meeting. So when they sat down, these people agreed that we take a solemn oath we will defend any visitor to Makkah, and we will not stop until the wealth of that person is returned to him. We're not going to stand up for injustice any longer. And they make some beautiful words. They said things like, as long as there's water in the sea, as long as there's branches on the trees, we're going to uphold our word. So the elderly gentlemen from many tribes, they gave their support, and they gave the youth the power. And the youth consisted of people from many tribes. So you couldn't blame one tribe that he's harming us, because all of them collectively. This now became the police, the safeguarding community. And that was led by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was he who led this. So whenever people would come to Makkah and anybody was insulted or treated unfairly, if that news reached the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would leave his occupation, gather youth that had agreed upon this, and they would all go and meet that individual, and they would force him to give the wealth back to the one that he has wrongfully taken from. This is the Messenger of Allah in his youth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upholding justice. This was known as al-hilf al-fudul. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was announced his prophecy, he found a lot of resistance from the people of Mecca. He's 13 years in Mecca of extreme importance in the day and age that we live in. And in difference to how the Quraysh started to behave with him, he would not resort to violence. He would walk past the Sahaba who were being insulted and harmed, and he would say to them, be patient, be patient. That was a reaction to violence that was perpetrated against him. Until he suggested to his companions, who were small in number, make your way to Abyssinia, because they have a Christian king who is just. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, recognized justice, even if it not be in his own city, vicinity, in the religion that he is bringing forth to mankind. Justice is what had to be upheld. So these people went over to Abyssinia, and they were given freedom under the rule of the King Najashi. The point to note is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recognizing truth, even if it be without him per se. Because Najashi was not at that time a follower of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was not a Muslim. The Messenger hadn't reached him. Later on, before he passed away, Allah gave him tawfiq and he became Muslim. But this is to show you, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not differentiate between religion. If justice is found, he supported it and he upheld it. When then, later in life, he had migrated to Medina, he saw a dream, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in this dream, he sees himself shaving his head and he performing Umrah. So he gathered the Sahaba together who had not seen Makkah and the Kaaba for 6 years. And he said to them, we're going to make our way to Makkah and perform Umrah of the house of Allah. The Sahaba overjoyed. We've not seen our beloved city for so long. So they all made their way. And then they stopped at a place called Hudaybiyah, which was just outside of Mecca. And they stopped there because the camel of the Messenger of Allah sat down, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Her name was Qaswa. She was the most beloved camel to the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now at Hudaybiyah, the Muslims were restricted from performing Umrah that year. And a treaty was made. This was a peace treaty. The beauty of this treaty is that no offer of the Messenger of Allah was accepted. Every claim or offer that the Quraysh placed forth was willingly accepted by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in order to maintain peace between communities. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then was given the victory at Mecca, and he came back a couple of years later for the Fath of Mecca, one of the Sahaba said, "This is the day of revenge. You people persecuted you and drove you out of your home, and now we're coming back and we shall take revenge." But the Messenger of Allah stopped him and said, "No, this is not the day of revenge. This is the day of mercy." So when he came back, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to his beloved city, and he gathered the Quraysh together, he asked them, "What do you think of me?" They said, "You are a noble brother, son of a noble brother. What shall I do to you?" And they said, "We only expect good from you." So he said to them, "La tathriba alaykum al-yawm. There is no questioning you today. Go, you're free. Antum tulaqa. Every one of you is let off. This is to show to you sanctity of life." The Messenger of Allah, from the very beginning of his life until his demise, always preferred to save human life. He would say to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala, "Do not like to meet the enemy at war. Do not like to meet the enemy at war." Meaning to say, that should be the very last thing before you pick up arms. There's many other things, consultation, treaties that could be made before you have to pick up arms against the people, against the nation. At one time in battle, the Messenger of Allah is en route to a battleground, and he finds some kittens, if I recall correctly, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed a companion beside them, and he made thousands of people change their direction so that these kittens are not harmed. He's going to war, and when people go to war, they go with a mindset of killing, of blood. But the Messenger of Allah is going with the intention of saving life. He would not even allow a kitten to be harmed en route to war. And then he laid down injunctions that if you meet an enemy at battle, then you do not kill a woman. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Do not kill a woman, do not kill a child." So when he once was at war, and at the end of the battle, he came into the battleground, he saw a lady killed, he grew in anger for the sake of Allah, enraged. And you know the Sahaba, they said, when he would be enraged, nobody could stand before him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was only for the sake of Allah. And he raised his voice towards the sky and said, "What did a lady have to do that she had to be killed?" Meaning, why was a lady killed? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you find in his own example, he would not take life except in necessity. We look at the age that we live in today. This is one of the biggest problems we have. Where any nation who has a bit of strength, they may call themselves superpowers, whatever it may be, the most developed nations, will willingly go and invade another nation, take lives of people, and call all innocent deaths as casualties of war without blinking an eyelid. This is what the world needs today. They need Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One historian said, a non-Muslim, I really liked what he said, but I don't recall his name, you may know his name. He said, if Muhammad was alive today, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he'd be able to resolve the issues of the world over a cup of tea. That's him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Safety of life, sanctity of life. You know, we're living as minorities, perhaps we may say, in the UK. And now we see so much Islamophobia on the rise. And it's a crime, we know it's a crime. And that's part of your duty if you do face Islamophobia, that you inform the authorities. So they register these crimes and they take some action based on what's happening against Muslims. But we're living as minorities in this country. You look at the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he ruled in Medina, there were minorities living in Medina. They were the settlers of Medina. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if the hadith you find in the Sahih of Imam Bukhari, he says, if anyone harms the wealth or the life of an ethnic or religious minority, then I will be his spokesperson before Allah on the day of judgment against you. He will stand on behalf of them in front of Allah against you because you were unjust to someone who was given right, protection of life, of wealth and honor under the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If the Messenger of Allah was alive today, and this was a Muslim land, and some non-Muslims were being persecuted, or there was a rise in phobia against them, I tell you by Allah, Rasulullah the first, to stop any phobia rising against people that he has given protection to. This is the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, always there defending people, upholding their rights, upholding their honor. The third thing, I should rather speak with the first thing which I left off. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to protect your religion, your faith, for many reasons. The ultimate goal being the pleasure of Allah, the knowing of Allah, that He is one, the Creator. But on a level where other people can take from Him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is lack of peace, inner peace and tranquility is something lost in our age. And not only in our age, throughout ages, people have always sought over inner peace, indifferent to their race, their creed, their color, their wealth, their background, their age, their gender, their abilities, the materialistic gain they have, the technological advancements they have, whatever time it may be, people have always sought after peace. And this is considered to be a universal issue. Anyone at any time, at any place, indifferent to how they may be or their background is, everyone, every human soul seeks peace. The Messenger of Allah came with peace. His name, the name of his religion is Islam. Our greeting is Assalamu alaikum. And Allah says, Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Nay, the peace of hearts, this inner peace you seek, will not be found except in the dhikr of Allah. So when you talk about upholding faith, from its many goals that have been found as to why we uphold our faith, one of them is to give this inner peace and tranquility to humankind. And Allah says Himself, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Whoever then moves away from my remembrance, he should have a distressful life, this life. And this is a fact. You can go to people who are faithless people, and they may have all the wealth of the world, but one thing they will not have is inner peace. Otherwise, why would you have a rise in depression and a rise in suicidal activities in very developed countries? It is because people are deprived of inner peace. Whilst you may go to a non-developed or developing country where there may be Muslims and there may be turmoil on its political level, and they've been living in turmoil for the last 40, 50, 60 years. Yet when you meet these people, you find peace with them because they've upheld their faith. One of the reasons as to why upholding faith is a goal of Islam. And you'll find this, anyone who reverted to Islam or anyone who's begun practicing only did so because they did not have inner peace. People only start taking on the religion and start practicing this deed is because they felt a vacuum of what did not exist. This is what Islam brings to the people of the world today. It's inner peace, peace of the outer, most definitely, in sanctity of life, and peace of the inner. Another thing, or the third thing that the Messenger of Allah came to uphold is your wealth. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, speaking to the Sahaba, he said to them, what day is this, and the day of Arafah, and what is this, and this is Kaaba, what city is this, and this is the Makkah, this is Makkah. And he said to them, that your blood, the blood of each other, your blood, your life, and your wealth, and your honor is sacred before you, like this month, or like this place, and another variant, like the house of Allah. This is the sanctity of wealth that the Messenger of Allah gave, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why you find our penal code, where if theft is committed, and the conditions are found, we find the amputating of the hand. It is because theft goes against the main principle of this religion. So the penalty placed for not observing the major principle is severe, so that people are deterred from committing this act, theft. Why? Because it harms your wealth. Now, we know in Islam that nobody can take your wealth from you. If your wealth is yours, nobody can take it from you. But there are circumstances where it's not allowed for you to keep your wealth. And we talked about the society we live in. The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prohibited hoarding. So if you had some type of wealth, food, and the people in the community, the marketplace, did not have this facility, did not have this type of food, you're not allowed to hoard, so that when nobody has this in their hands, you will bring it out in the market and sell it at an extortionate price. The Messenger of Allah prohibited this, despite the fact it's your wealth. Why? Because there's harm to the community. Something that you may well know if you are involved in planning, town planning, or if you've perhaps experienced this in the country that we live in. Do you know what a CPO is? We call this a compulsory purchase order, some laws, right? Because you may have experienced this or you know of this. A compulsory purchase order from the town planning is whereby they force you to sell. You have to sell your property. You have no right left. This is an Islamic invention. This is an Islamic principle that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not allow anyone to touch your wealth unless your wealth was harmful for the greater good. At that time, he would force for you to sell. This is what we call today a compulsory purchase order, which the West finds itself to be a developed nation by means of their principles they have time planning. Something Rasulullah taught 1400 years prior about the right and benefit of communities overrides individual benefit. This is upholding the wealth of people, upholding the property of people. You know, when you study economics, and any of you who study economics, right, even today, the very basic thing for a transaction to take place is offer and acceptance. These are some principles that the Messenger of Allah laid down about making an offer and making an acceptance, and what constitutes an offer, what does not constitute an offer, what constitutes an acceptance, what is not an acceptance, can you sell with conditions, can you not sell with a condition. You study Islamic economic law, it's detailed. You then can compare that with the Western law today, and you find that the principles are exactly the same. Almost seems like someone's copied another, but they continue to develop. You see, this is 1400 years prior. We take it for granted. When we think the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to perform such a thing, or he said such a thing which fits in the age today, look at other civilizations. You know, one of the things that we criticize over are our treatment, or supposedly mistreatment of women. Well, this, the world that we live in, the United Nations, which is very good in the United Nations, when they talk about their charter of human rights is in the late, in the 1940s, when they start talking about freedom of human beings and no slavery and freedom of women and the rights they hold. You know, this is new phenomena. And this is the West. We're talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 1400 years ago, let alone women. His own first wife, Sayyidina Khadija, is a businesswoman. He works for his wife. Then he becomes a partner with his wife. She's not just a businesswoman. She's a very successful businesswoman. This is his wife or partners, and they spend their wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His second wife is Zayda Sawda. She's a black lady. At that time, this was frowned on. People were scared slaves if they had that color. The Messenger of Allah accepted one of them as his wife. The third wife he had, and his youngest and most beloved wife, Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she is the teacher of this ummah. He made her the teacher. After his demise, she would sit in the masjid and she would relate to people the hadith of Rasulullah and teach him ruling of this thing, a lady, a woman. A teacher of men of this nation, without a hadith, would struggle. This is the position he gave to his woman folk. His granddaughter, Sayyidina Zainab, radiallahu ta'ala anha, had the courage to speak up in front of an oppressor in his palace, Yazid ibn Muawiyah. She was able to speak up in front of an oppressor and speak the truth in front of him. Who gave her this courage and honor and dignity and chivalry? It was Islam. It was the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab became the Khalifa, he appointed people in the market to ensure no one was cheating. From these people who would govern the market, there were women. There were women amongst them. The very first shaheed in Islam is a lady. This is what Islam gives to them. They have right to vote. They have right to suggest. You find many examples of ladies coming to the Amir al-Mu'mineen and voicing their opinion. This is, you know, now it's common, now it's accepted, now it's norm. But 1400 years ago, the people just a few years prior would kill women folk, girls. This messenger has transformed that community. You know the example of Sayyidina Umar is very well known, where he told his wife not to go to the masjid. And she said back, is this a prohibition? Because she understood the messenger of Allah did not prohibit us. So he said, no, mashallah. Because wisdom is the lost property of Muslims. When we see that the world has advanced and given rights to women, we say, MashaAllah, they've caught up. This is exactly what's happened. Let alone the contributions of Muslims who came later, after the Prophet ﷺ, and their contributions to science and to civilizations and mathematics based upon which the world has developed to where it has developed today. We say, MashaAllah, that the world has taken from the Muslims. What we don't like is not to accept what you've taken from. Most certainly, the world has developed and there's been a major part to play by the Muslim civilization, the contribution to the world that we live in today. We should read our history. We don't read. Another of the objectives of Islam. Why am I thinking about these objectives and how it's relevant to the title? It's because you don't need to look at an example, physical, practical example in the life of the Messenger of Allah for the age and day we live in. No, look only at his practice, look at his words, look at his teachings, because they are as important as his practice. When we forget this, when we look at the world today and we think, well, let's see how the Messenger of Allah behaved, most definitely let's look at how he behaved, but also look at what he taught. His teachings are as important, if not more important, than his own practice. And his teachings are where we have principles that govern human life. And that seems to be applied in the day and age that we live in today. What would Rasulullah do? When we look at his words and teachings, that's how he would behave. Because this is what he taught, this is what he left, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the major things that Islam comes to uphold is your reason, is your reasoning, your intellect. The basis of this is don't drink alcohol as an intoxicant, because it does away with your intellect. How much a crime is going to be found tonight in this country? It's going to be in the high. The community knows this. Why? Because people will get a bit excited and drink too much, and it will lead to rising crime. And the government knows. But yet, because it doesn't have divine principles by which it can govern itself, while its human mind will start to think what's good for them, and the human mind doesn't always know what's good for them, they allow crime to take place, and there's a rise. But the Muslims, we have divine intervention. We have divine principles telling us, avoid this because this is not good for you. So Islam has come and has told us, do not consume intoxicants. This is what the world needs. If the world, as it prohibited slavery, to prohibit intoxicants. Well, it's going to be seem a very far-fetched and wild thing in the community, because that's what they dwell on, you know, in the West, as you probably very well know. When I was at university, if we got a coursework, they would say, let's go have a drink. If they passed, they'd say, let's have a drink. If they failed, let's have a drink. If they've given their coursework in, let's have a drink. It's break, let's have a drink. We'll come back. It doesn't stop. That's their community. So for me to say this to them is wild. But I'm not concerned about them. I'm concerned about truth. This is what Islam teaches. It's Sirat al-Mustaqim. It's being fair and just. And justice will be when this world comes back to the middle, which is that as it prohibited slavery, it prohibits any such thing that affects the minds of people whereby they will go and commit crime. Because of what happens. And then all of a sudden it's as if it's acceptable. So you see, it's not about fitting Islam into the West or fitting Islam into the 21st century. No. Islam is there and it's like a shining sun and it's bright and it's leading the way. But if people, Muslims, don't uphold their religion, or if others have advanced and taken a particular stance, it does not take anything away from the light of the sun. Islam is as it is. Another thing that Islam came to uphold, and this is beautiful, is your honor and your lineage. This is one of the reasons as to why a Muslim male man is permitted to marry a Christian Jewish lady, but a Muslim woman is not permitted to marry a Christian Jewish man because of protection of your lineage. Because customarily, it's the child who will take the religion of the father. This is one of the wisdoms behind certain marriages were permitted and certain marriages were not permitted. And this also, if a lady is, if there's fornication or adultery that's taking place, certain penalties have been placed down and very severe penalties have been placed and laid down in order to protect lineage and honor of the community. But one of them things where the protection of honor comes in is having no discrimination or being indiscriminate towards your race. Racism is a problem today and it's thriving. And you can't say just because you placed a human charter in the United Nations in 1948 that there is no racism. That's just a lie. Racism is on high, even today. In the millions of people. People are racist. It's almost innate in them. But look at the charter, the human charter, that the Messenger of Allah placed. He places on his farewell Hajj. And he said, O mankind, look at the words of the Messenger of Allah. He didn't say, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, O Muslims, because only Muslims were there. At Hajj with him, he was addressing all of mankind. So he said, O mankind, i.e., you will pass on my message. You will pass on my message. O mankind, your Lord is one, just as your father is one, meaning Adam alayhi salam. And then he placed his human charter of equality, of justice, of human rights, of ethics and morality. And he said, which was the most fought over thing amongst Arabs, he said, no Arab has any superiority over a non-Arab. And vice versa. And no white person has any superiority over a black person, and vice versa, except by piety. Except piety with Allah. The more righteous you are, the closer you are to Allah. That's where your superiority lies. Nothing to do with your race, nothing to do with your color. This is the same charter. This is what Allah announces. Ya ayyuhan nas, exactly the same. O mankind. Inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. We have created you from a male and female. Waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabail. And we have placed you in nations and tribes. So this is the phenomena of Allah, that He's made us different in color, in race, in nationalities, in language. But should this be a cause of harm and difference and discrimination? No, Allah says, لِتَعَارَفُوا. Why have I placed you in such ways
so that you recognize each other, so you're able to talk and converse with each other. You could use these differences as a means of joining and agreeing, not dividing further. And then who is the best nation? Which is the best color? Which is the best race and language? It's not a color or race or language. Allah says, "Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum." The most noble amongst you before Allah is the one who is most God pious, the one who has most God consciousness, who has piety in his heart. So when we talk about Islam in the world, the day and age we live in, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is beyond the 21st century. By Allah, it is beyond the 21st century. He came to take people out of darkness. Had he not come, people would have dwelled further into darkness. And now the world has gone to the other extreme and fallen into darkness again. That's where it's in. It now uses the wisdom card, the peace card, to go and commit oppression. And Allah says in the Quran, so when you ask them, why are you calling fasad fil ard? قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُصْلِحُونَ. We're peacemakers. Right? You must have seen that Facebook kind of pic with David Cameron and that verse. It fits with him. With him and Bush and Blair and all of them that came before them. Anybody who committed atrocities unjustly. But you look at the example of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's seated with his Sahaba. And some of the people amongst him don't believe in him, but they behave as if they're Muslim. So you should be upfront. I believe in you, I believe in you. I don't believe in you, no problem, don't believe in me. Right? Let it go, have it deep. There's no compulsion, you don't have to become Muslim. That's up to you. There's going to be a consequence if you accept or you don't accept. That's for the hereafter. In this life, you have the right. Be as you like. Right? Let it go, have it deep. There's no compulsion, we don't force people to become Muslim. Neither is our command from the Lord Almighty. Right, but what we don't like, and the Prophet ﷺ disliked, was someone who would on the face say, I'm a Muslim, but in the heart disbelieve. So we call this in our language hypocrisy. Right? So these people were hypocrites. They would say one thing with their tongue and believe another with the heart. So Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, he said to the Messenger of Allah, oh Messenger of Allah, look at these people, they're committing treason. You know, the penalties of treason. Because now, when you use that word, it's fine to go and invade lands or kill people or whatever you want to do. They're committing treason. So let's give them the punishment. Look at the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, no, I fear that people will say about me that Muhammad kills his own people. You see, the image of Islam was before the eyes of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We know when we pray, we say, mashallah, the munshidun, our nadkhawaz, amazing. And we say, this practice is a sunnah. And look at the proof we give is Sayyidina Hassan ibn Thabit, that the Messenger of Allah placed him on the pulpit. He brought the pulpit in for him, made him sit on the pulpit and made him honor the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and sing praise in honor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave the reward to him. You know why that was done? It was not because Rasulullah wanted to hear his praise. No, he's the most humble of all people. He, Allah praising him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. He doesn't need human praise. So why was Hassan bin Thabit made to praise? Is to honor Islam. Because people had used poetry to dishonor Islam. So Rasulullah used the same media of the age to honor Islam, to honor the Prophet, because he is the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. See the wisdom he had. Now, when he was in Medina, he came to Medina and Munawwara, and there were settlers of different faiths, like the Jewish tribes. He made a charter with them, a pact, a constitution. I'm the governor of the city. But you have a right to practice your religion as freely as you will, and if you have any issues, you may go to your own religion and you may have them judging you. There's no issue. But if it's brought to me, the Prophet says, as the governor of the city, I'm going to judge by Islam. So the Jewish people had full right to go practice their religion and not interrupt. When we take this today as being something great in the West, we say, yes, you've caught up with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He gives us freedom of religion. He gives freedom of thought and speech. He allowed this to happen in the community that he lived in. So when some of these people, please mark my words, it's not necessarily the Jewish way, some of these people committed treason. And you find now in the West that if somebody commits treason, there is a very possibility of them being taken to task. Life, that would be the punishment. Death, in life is taken away. But the Messenger of Allah, look at his rahmah, his mercy. Treason was committed once. He did not punish them. He said to them, I let you leave with your belongings. They were exiled. But they could have been killed. He said, no, I let you go. You're free, go. You can't live here amongst us because you committed treason. I don't want to take your life. Go with your wealth. That is mercy. And then the second time treason took place, he didn't kill them. He said, I let you go as well. Go. No harm. And they were safety and protection was given to them until they reached their place that they want to go to. And then when the final third time treason happened, which was now really going a bit too much, and people were willing to work with the enemies of the Messenger of Allah and backstab him, you know, nobody would like that to take place for themselves. And likewise the Prophet ﷺ, even then he did not say kill them. No. He said to them, choose someone that you want to be a judge for you. And they told the Sahabi, who was a Jewish man, who knew very well, he wasn't a Jewish man, but he knew the Jewish tribe and the law very well, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, if I recall. And one of the Sahaba, may not be Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, that's right. The Ash-Shuk, that he said, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, radiallahu ta'ala, he's from the Aws. Now Sa'd ibn Mu'adh was chosen by them, by the Jewish people, and he was going to pass judgment by their elected ruler that you committed treason according to your law, you must be put to death. This was done by their own law. You see, the Messenger of Allah was always there, full of mercy. Full of mercy. So Muslims should not feel discouraged or should not feel that we don't have what it takes to be able to stand up tall before the world that we live in. Wallahi, it's not the case. We look at the contributions of the Muslims, something that, you know, every Pakistani here asked my father's in Kashmir, like many of you guys are. Every Pakistani elder, Kashmiri elder, Indian Bengali elder, who's come to the subintercontinent, one thing they said when they came to this land, and they phoned back, they were not phones, they were letters, is they give you child benefit. They give the place to live. They give you child benefit. Well, mashallah, that's beautiful. But who invented child benefit? Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, the Khalifa of the Messenger of Allah. He is the one who, in fact, if not his invention, why? He only manifested the wisdom and justice of the Messenger of Allah upon his people as he saw fit. He would patrol the city of Medina himself, and one night he patrolled the city of Medina and he placed child benefit, but only after the child had been weaned off the mother's chest. So he stood outside one home and a child is crying. So he waited and he waited and he waited, but the child continued to cry. So he knocked the door and he said to the lady, I am Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar. So the door was open and he said to her, why is he crying, the baby? And the mother said, because I'm trying to wean off the child so that we are eligible for child tax benefit. Pardon my words, I'm only using words so that you are able to understand what's being said. So Sayyidina Umar returned back. And he reproached himself saying, what a violent man you are, Umar. How many of children have you deprived of their mother's milk? Because mothers who are poor wanted their child to come off their milk as soon as possible so they are eligible for some money. So when he went back, he changed the law, of course, with consultation. Because consultation is how Muslim law works. With consultation, he consulted the pastor new rule. And the new rule was, you will become eligible for child benefit as soon as the child is born. So now all children remained on the mother's chest for 2 years. No child was deprived of the milk. This is the wisdom of the Prophet ﷺ. He put justice into people. Justice, this is the key. So when we look at the world today, irrelevant, there is security with numbers, right? And that's how the world is today. I'm going to stop. I've spoken for a long time. But Sayyidina Ali said, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, these words are very pertinent in our age. He said, don't judge truth by people. So don't look at people and think, well, they must be untruth because there's so many of them. Find the truth first, and then find who's with it. So upholding truth, upholding justice. This is what Islam came to give. And it gives. And it continues to give. If people who uphold the name of Islam don't follow the instructions, it takes nothing away from the religion. The religion is pure. The messenger of this religion is the purest. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah Ta'ala elevate the rank of our beloved messenger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to share with you one last thing, nothing to do with the topic that I've been given. Allah Ta'ala accept what has been said and any mistakes for me. Ameen. Allah pardon me for my mistakes. One of the things I thought about this Mawlid al-Sharif, and I'm sure you've all been thinking better than myself, is can you just imagine the rank of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Not only does Allah send salah upon him, not only does Allah send durood upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Allah tells us to send durood, salah and salah on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what do we say back? We say, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Oh Allah, you send salah on the Prophet Muhammad. But Allah has instructed us to do it. To which we're saying, Allahumma, or even though Allahumma is saying, Sallaytu ala Muhammad, Salatu wassalamu alayhi ya Rasulullah. That's the command we've been given. You, believers, you send salah and salam on the Messenger of Allah. But what's the most oft-quoted version of salam and salah is, Allahumma salli ala. Oh Allah, you send salah and salam on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? It's because we don't know the rank of Rasulullah. We can't do justice to his rank, so we ask Allah to do this for us. Which is, oh Allah, you send salah upon him anyway, and you know him better than we do, so on our behalf, you send salah on the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the angels of Allah are coming down, and they come 70,000 in the morning, and 70,000 in the evening, and they do the exact same thing, and the Lord Almighty himself send salah on the Messenger of Allah. Can you imagine the rank of Rasulullah being raised every instant and moment before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If we think we know him, well now we don't. And if we think we know him now, well now we don't. Because so much more has been sent upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah ta'ala keep him alive in our hearts and our lives. May the Mawlid gathering continue throughout the year where we learn about him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Barakallahu feekum. I also like to thank again Sid Hamza and Mustafa Center. It's always an honor to come here. I really enjoy it and like it. People have loved some beautiful faces. Many I know, some I don't. Allah bless you all. Inshallah, have a good one. Last thing, I forgot this one. This is important. You know the West that we live in, if you go into a Google search, if you get like a search engine optimizer, an SEO, he'll tell you this. Do you know what's going to be the most searched thing tonight? It's going to be how to lose weight. The New Year's resolution. Come to the Messenger of Allah, he teaches you. He said, eat a third, drink for a third of your stomach, and eat a third to breathe. That's it. You don't need to pay all these amounts in order to find how to lose weight. He's given us guidance on every aspect of life. Barakallahu feekum, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa sallam, alhamdulillah.